Ah yes, dB-Meters, the perfect tool to see exactly how loud something is. Or is it? Let's start with a simple example. Two sounds, which of them is louder? I think we can all agree the square wave sounded a lot louder, right? I mean, the square wave basically is the sine wave plus some more stuff on top. On the decibel meter, both sounds peak at exactly the same level though, and yet one of them is clearly louder. How's that possible? The truth is, decibel meters only measure the amplitude of a signal, well, at least if it's true peak metering. Peak metering only measures the highest samples, which is even more inaccurate. But what both peak metering and true peak metering don't take into account is that a square wave spends a lot more time at that amplitude, while the sine wave also spends a lot of time here in the middle. A way to address this problem is to instead use the root mean squared or RMS level. Instead of the highest peak, this calculates an average over a certain time. But of course we aren't done yet, here's another example. As you can hear, a sine wave at 400 Hz sounds a lot quieter than a sine wave at 3000 Hz, although both are still the same decibel, even on an RMS meter they're the same. The reason for this is that the human hearing is not linear. These are the so-called Fletcher-Munson curves. This is basically the correction we would have to apply so that the sine wave has the same loudness no matter what note we play. At least as long as we don't go into inaudible range, of course. But as you can see in this curve, a sine wave at 3000 Hz will sound a lot louder than a sine wave at 400 Hz. But we are still not done yet. Well, it might seem a bit obvious, but a long sustained sound will also sound louder than just a short blip. But we are already averaging the peak over time, right? The question is just over how much time. So maybe we shouldn't just average over a couple of milliseconds, but whether a whole second, or maybe 10, or a minute. So what do we even need all this for? Why is it important to know how loud something is? At this point, let's go back in time a bit. Back in the days, loudness normalization relied purely on peak levels. But as we already understood, peak levels really aren't a good way of measuring how loud something is. This led to considerable loudness differences in programs and broadcast channels. So they invented a standard, so-called Loudness Units or LU. Well, and also LUFS or Loudness Units Full Scale. That's basically the same, just that LU is relative, while LUFS is normalized to the full scale of digital audio. So this is what Loudness Units do. They do frequency weighting, they do mean square calculations, they ignore silence, so everything under a certain threshold, and for the RMS they also define three time windows. 400 milliseconds for a momentary loudness, 6 seconds for short-term loudness, and integrated loudness averages the loudness over the whole song, or the whole movie, or whatever you want to integrate over. In practice, the integrated loudness is what's usually used for normalization. For example, the broadcast industry has agreed to an integrated loudness of -23 LUFS, and most streaming platforms like YouTube or Spotify normalize to -14 LUFS. To be clear, what that means for you is that if you upload something on YouTube and it's over -14 LUFS, it will get turned down so that it is -14 LUFS. However, if you upload something that's quieter than -14 LUFS, it won't be turned up, as this might introduce clipping. You'll just stay quieter than the standard in this case. If you right-click on a YouTube video and go on Stats for Nerds, you can actually see the content loudness relative to the -14 LUFS reference and how much they turned it down. As you can see in this video, it was 3.1 dB louder than -14 LUFS, so -10.9 LUFS. LUFS actually uses the same scale as decibels, so if you have a track that's -14 LUFS integrated and turn it up by 3 decibels, it will be -11 LUFS. So YouTube just turned down my video by 3.1 decibels and now you can listen to it at the same loudness as all other content on the platform, which is -14 LUFS. Let's end this video by telling you what you should do in practice. If you're uploading music to platforms like YouTube, it makes sense to try to master it above minus 14 LUFS so it doesn't end up quieter than other songs on the platform. Quieter music will always sound weaker and less immersive, so unless it's so quiet that people will turn it up manually, being quieter than minus 14 LUFS is usually not desirable for music. However, at least for me, my tracks usually end up at around minus 10 LUFS automatically without caring about loudness at all, so in most cases you won't have to worry about that at all. I should mention that despite it being widely used, integrated loudness is not perfect. For example, songs with a long and slow build-up will have a much louder finale than songs with a high energy throughout the whole track. That's also why I personally, when doing DJ mixes, use short-term loudness for normalization, since that does a much better job for at least the specific use case. And while I personally am not a big fan of doing things in your tracks just for the sake of loudness, if you really still want to win the loudness war, you could pretty easily abuse this floor by making a long intro or outro that doesn't go under the threshold, which will bring down the integrated loudness and therefore makes your track louder than others. But again, that's nothing I would recommend, just a thought experiment. Lastly, I want to say that this doesn't mean at all that decibel meters are useless. They are great for seeing how close you are to clipping and for just getting a simple response without having to understand any calculations. I hope you learned something new from this video, and I'll see you next time.